about glorified thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was.
That's right. So give me, put me back to where I was before the world was. Get me back to my status. That's what he was just telling me for. A man is a been made man was a what? A level, a degree lower, as we read in the Psalms, a lower than his heavenly existence, his pre-existence. He submitted himself to become a man. It wasn't nowhere near like being what he had as up there with God. He said, but what he had up there with God, he didn't brag about it. But he sure wanted it. Ooh, man, I miss it. We call it a glorified body, but I think it's something more glorious than that. Sometimes he displayed a little bit of it every once in a while. Walk through a wall. Oh, hey, Jesus. Open the door for you to get in here. Do stuff like that. Pop up. You're out there fishing on the lake. You know, people come say, oh, well, what y'all doing? I'm trying to get something to eat. Who are you? And then he get mad at him. You don't know who I am. That's how he was. Sleeping on a boat. Water. About to kill them all. They wake him up. He's sleeping. They're scared to death. He's sleeping. Hey, man, we're about to drown. What you sleeping about? He wake up and said, what is your faith? What are you worried about? You a man. What are you worried about? Take care of this. I said, oh, you take care of it. You woke me up to take care of it? Yeah. I said, okay, I'll take care of it. How long am I going to put up with y'all? People with no faith. That's what he said. All y'all, a little bit of faith. How long? Woke me up. Calm a storm. But what are we doing now? The wind get up mad. Run for the shelter. Turn on the TV, the radio. Look for the worst. Instead of what? Take a vote. Woo, somebody have a hand.
Colossians describes Jesus, the Son, mm-hmm. as the first, the image. It says, who is the image of the invisible God, mm-hmm. the firstborn of mm-hmm. every creature.
Yeah, we'll get to that. Before God, you're going with that. So, that's what we got. Jesus wanted to get back to where he was. Right? That's what you call being in control of your class. We're going to peanut section.
Just sitting here thinking about, I don't know if you'll be able to really sell that. The first Superman movie and the way that he was sent, mm-hmm. you know, the earth and mm-hmm. all that. Mm-hmm. And I was thinking of closely that was to how God and Jesus must have got together, you know, sending you down here.
Right.
This is going to happen. This is what you, you know, mm-hmm. that plan of what they must have did.
They took it off of them. Hollywood does a lot of things off of biblical truths. Now, can you imagine this one? Okay. Now, Jesus wanted to get back to where he was before he became man. There's only one way back. You got to do what?
Die.
Now, let's look at the reality of that dying. St. John 10. We're going to get to our lesson scriptures right after this one, I promise you. St. John 10. 17. Okay. Now, he said here, we're going to have to kill you. That's what the devil said, that people think. We're going to kill him. We're going to kill him. Jesus says, you can't kill me. Yeah, we're going to kill you. So, then Jesus gives them this reality. What does he say there, verse 17? 17 and 18.
Therefore doth my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I might take it again. No man take it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father.
Stands. All right, praise God. Therefore do my Father love me. I'm going to jump to verse 18. No man take it from me. No one takes my life from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down. I have power to take it again. This authority, this commandment I have of my Father. So this is why he knew that even though I'm a human being, in human form, no one can kill me. No one can take my life from me. He says, I'm going to surrender my life. Because that's in the master plan. God so loved the world that he gave his son to be a sacrifice for sin to save the world. So Jesus wanted to get back into that glory where he was before he came to earth. The only way back is that you got to lay down your life voluntarily. He says, I do it. And the Father says, you also have the power to take it back up. A crazy man and the devil thought they was killing him and all like that. The scripture points out later that if the devil knew what he was doing, he would have never killed him. He would have done anything else but killed him. Because once he killed Jesus, he had to get buried into the heart of the earth, and then he went down into the heart of the earth, and he woke up. When he woke up, he saw where he was, and he destroyed everything down there. And then he came back and says, look what I got. All now. Even the stuff that he stole from Adam and Eve, I got that. That's what he told man. So, so his way back was to lay down his life, and he laid down his life. Now, we're going to read verse 6 again of our lesson, Philippians, the second chapter. Who being in the form of God, thought it not what? Robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no what? And took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. Okay. Now this is the key for us. These next verses is the way that we exist victorious here on earth. Everything else that we talked about prior to this was the way that he did it. Now it's the way that we got it. Made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant, of a what? Servant. And was made in the likeness of man. Been found in fashion as a man, he did what?
Humbled
himself. That's lesson number one. The lesson number one. Humble yourself. Oh, man. I don't know about it. Come on. I got to do what? You got to humble yourself. First thing, you got to humble. Let the preacher humble me. Let him preach fire and brimstone on Sunday. That'll straighten me out. You got to. Every man has got this pride. Every human being's got this pride. You got to prove it to me. You got to show me that you're better than me to make me bow down to you. To do it your way. Everybody got to deal with that. I've got a brain. I'm born with some sense. I had a mom and daddy told me how to do. What do you think? Everybody, am I saying something that y'all never heard? So everybody got that humility issue. But let's see what happens if you do voluntarily humble yourself. I just want to know what Hebrews 1 and 3 says before we go any further. I think that might have been where it came. What do we say there? Yeah, that's what Candy was. What does it say there?
Being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high.
Okay, right. We took you out two birds and one stone. We see him in the image of God. And we see him after he had done his work that the Father wanted him to do. He sat down in a low place or in a high place?
High place.
He sat down in a high place. When he had done what God wanted him to do, he humbled himself to do God's will. He humbled it so much that he had to give his life. After he had completed the work, he sat in a high place. Woo! That's why the preacher says at Northside that if you want to go up, you got to first go what?
Down.
Some weird addition. If you want to go up, you got to first go down. And that's what Jesus did. He humbled himself. Although he had all of this about him and everything, he says, I willingly humble myself to death so he can sit on the right hand of the majesty of God. And that's what he is. Yes, sir.
Let me go back to that. Part of verse 7, where he says, and took upon him the form of a servant.
Yeah, he took upon him the form of a servant. Yeah, he looked like a slave. He obeyed like a slave would obey. You say it, I do. Your will, I do. And that's what he was saying to the Father. Your will, I do. Although he come from splendor, step into a body, he said, whatever you say, I do. Whatever you say, I do. Your plan. Your work you want me to do, I do. And then he says, but I want to get back to where I was with you. It's going to be... You have to volunteer to die. I'll do it. Volunteer to die. Not only did he volunteer to die, he took his position. And where is his position? High position. That's how you work with God. Do it that way. Man, I ain't doing that way. I got my own brain. I got my own sense. I ain't crazy. I got my own thoughts. I got my own opinion. I would do. Man, I got my own life. You want to go up? Humble yourself. That's what he said right here, right? He took upon verse 8, and been found in fashion as a man. Let's see, then the scripture started off, let this attitude be in you. So as a man, I do what? Humble myself. As a human being, I humble myself, and I become obedient. What's the extent of my obedience to God? Whoa. Well, if you say that you can't do it, then you don't believe that your Savior did it. You say, I can't obey somebody all the way to the grave. Come on. If you can't do it, then you don't believe he did it. And that's what's called a paradigm. It's called a mind change. It's called repentance. Repentance is nothing more than a mind change. My attitude, my thinking, I change. That's all repentance is. Some think it's a spiritual deal. Would you hang off the chandeliers and dance through the church and all that? That's not what I'm going to do. I see them do that and go back like that and do the same thing. So it's a mind change, it's an attitude change that I'm gonna be like this, following my Savior all the way to death. Okay. Even now, he died, that's death. But he took this death further than what anybody else would go. We went a step further, just to solidify it. How far was that? Whoa. I heard about this guy, this internet guru, 28 years old, and hung himself. Y'all heard about him? You invited with me? You hear about that young kid? He has 24 something. He helped bring the internet on. So he's got all of this will of fabulous everything. Right. But he suffered from depression. And they said that he stole some internet secrets or something like that. I mean, he can get to your computer. And he got all these other records because he knew how to deal with that stuff. And so they had him up for 35 years and charged him 35 years and so many, much money in fines. And he couldn't, and he suffered from depression. He couldn't take it. So he just, they take life. So he killed himself, 28 years old. Brilliant mind and all like that. Death. We say death is terrible. So yeah, death is terrible. That's what Jesus did. He said, I'll go ahead and taste death. I'm going to take it a little even more extreme. Not the hanging kind of death, but the death on a what? Cross. Man, you got to die. Don't die on a cross.
That was more of a human form of death.
Yeah.
The first death.
It's also a set of spiritual significance in that. Yeah. Okay, but I think
that's what I was asking. Yeah. First death was a spiritual death, where it says it began to death. And then even death on the cross.
Yeah, the death on the cross, the death on the cross is that if before you die on the cross, you have to become cursed. So from all the splendor with the Father before the world was, to stepping into a body, and then not only being willing to die, but to be cursed and then die. Whoa. Cursed and then die. That means that you, just the lowest of the lowest you will be before you die. And so how did he die? Describe that. Full of sickness. Full of sin. Poverty stricken. No way to God. That's how he died. He had that curse on him first, and then he died. The Bible says, the spiritual reality is that cursed is everyone that does what?
Hang on the tree.
That's scripture. If you get on that tree, if you die hanging on a cross, it's because you were cursed. Cursed is everyone that's hanging on the tree. So, Jesus died a curse, not just ending death, last heartbeat. He died a curse for you and for me. Everything contrary to life, that's what he was when he hung on that cross. Ooh. Mm. You mean it wasn't as pretty like most churches have a little pretty Jesus, ain't it? Go to the wrong Sunday school class, you'll see a pretty Jesus hanging on that cross. That's not the way it was. How did he look? Hanging on that cross. Look at Isaiah 52. The last verse in Isaiah 52nd chapter. Let's see what he looked like. I'm going to put him in there real quick. I know my time's going to run out. I'm going to be like Pastor Hill, I get ahead of them before they Okay, Isaiah 52, last two verses is verses 14 and 15. And look what he said in verse 13 about his servant. This is a prophet. Behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very what? He's going to wind up being very high. And then what happens to him in verse 14 and 15? Someone read that, please.
Many were astonished at thee.
Mm-hmm.
His visage was so marred, more than any man, and his form more than the son of man.
We can do without 15, but that's what it looked like. His appearance, his visage, that's his appearance. They beat him, spit on him, kicked him, beat him to death. He was so bad, beaten up with that whip and everything, that you couldn't recognize him as a man. That's a dying curse on the cross. That's how bad he looked. He didn't look like a man, even hanging on the cross. So, and he's on that cross, and he's not dead yet. That's just the way he looks from the beating he got before they posted him up there. Now you go to Isaiah 53. Now, 53 and 1 has one important question to be answered. And what is that? Who will believe this? That's what he says. Who will believe this? Then, you want to identify with that, and you jump into verse 5. Let's look at the scripture yourself. Verse 4. He bore our griefs, he carried our sorrows. We did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Verse 5. He was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, when his stripes were what?
Yeah.
Where's the flu season?
Ooh, what? Ooh, ooh.
Where the fly?
What am The Lord is the strength of my life. The Lord is my life, my salvation. What should I bear for that flu? Is there a good mileage for that or what? Who will believe this? Wow. So, and that's everything that happened to him, he did what? It was for who? Us. He became a curse for us. This stands out, this separates Christianity from everything else in existence. Okay, Buddha died. What did he do for you before he died? Muhammad's word? What did he do for you? Sister Soldier, where'd she go? What she do before she died? No reports. Who? That's what he says, 53. Who would believe this? Dare tell you that? Wow. Now, if you can get some faith in this, you can walk the earth power. Okay, we took a side journey. We better get back to our lesson. Was it still ringing the bell? All right. So that's Matthew, and then you got the just for your Romans 14 and 9. He had to be exalted. That shows you his exaltation. Ephesians 1 and 20. From the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. Ephesians 1 and 20. So he's exalted. After he humbled himself, he was exalted. Okay. Hebrews 12, 22. As we read verse 9. I said 2. Yeah, okay. So read verse 9. It says, wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. Look at Hebrews 12 and 2. I'm ashamed. Has lost his life. It's not the same. Ephesians 12 and 2. I think I must have messed with it. What does 12 and 2 say?
Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down on at the right hand of the throne of God.
Yeah, so there you go. So, He despising the shame, sat down at the right hand of God after he went through the work that he had to do. That's his exaltation. Then Colossians 2:15, if you look there real quick, Colossians 2:15. What did he do when he was... in hell?
Heaven's four principalities and powers.
Mm-hmm.
He made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it.
While he was in hell, that's what he did for us. Okay, that's the work he did to be exalted. Okay, all right, now, since he's done all that work, and everybody say, I'm my own man, nobody can tell me nothing. Hebrews 12:22. Let's see. I don't have to accept Jesus as Savior. I don't have to. I said Hebrews 12.
Is that the one you want?
No, I don't think that was it.
I don't think so.
Let's go ahead with verse 10. Someone read out of our lesson, please.
That in the name of Jesus, mm-hmm. every knee should bow of things in heaven mm-hmm. and things in earth mm-hmm. and things under the earth.
Who we going to bow?
Every knee.
Believers and non-believers?
Everybody.
I don't like that, Jesus.
Every
I never did accept him. Don't worry about it. You will. He's got to set up to where you will. You either gonna submit now or you'll submit a little bit later. Don't worry about it. You either submit now and get the benefits or you'll submit later and pay the consequences. So every knee shall bow. And he's already demonstrated this. Oh yeah, I'm going to get him to bow. First, Pastor mentioned this Wednesday night, that first resurrection. There was some bowing then. And we're waiting on the second bowing event. When would that be? It would be the rapture. You think he's just going to appear in the sky and say, hey, homie, here we go. I'm ready to ride. Where's my seat? No. That's my Lord. Then you can jump on with it. And that every tongue, some of them, the ones that don't believe, no, everyone's with bad attitudes. It says what? Every tongue. She'll confess. Why is it like that? Because he merited. He earned that spot. All the creation is going to bow to him. Do it now or later. Make up your mind. That spiritual bow. He won't be cutting a jig and all that. Time to, whoa, that's my Lord. Then you fly away. And then those that's in the book of Revelation, just for your record, Revelation 5, 11, and 13, it's going to be those that don't, they'll wait till later. Got a little heat for you. Yeah. Fly on your way. I don't have time to look at that, but that's what's going to happen if you don't accept him now. Why? Because he paid a tremendous price from splendor to a body. From a body to a curse, from a curse to death. And you say, I don't know. Life is all over, God says, sit right here. Sit right here on my right hand. So I'll make all your enemies different. So the lesson in submission and exaltation. Hallelujah.